Okay, good afternoon, everybody. I'm Giovanni Rum. I'm a senior advisor at the Italian Space Agency. First of all, let me thank the organizer to have accepted to organize this session in which we would like to give you a quick, but I hope rather complete overview of what are the current developments in Italy that are both related to improving and increasing our infrastructure and also develop services for our institutional users. Of course, infrastructure and services mainly based on Earth observation data. We will have some, I hope, some question and answer after each presentation, but at the end, we have reserved some time to a discussion with the audience. Okay, so let me go straight, and I would like first to invite to the podium Professor Andrea Taramelli, which is our national representative in the Copernicus program, and is also the coordinator of the National User Forum for Copernicus. Of course, the forum is also dealing with application of other data and services. Professor Taramelli, thank you.
Thanks, Giovanni. Thanks for inviting me in this session. I will try to be fast, but to give an overview of what is happening in Italy right now. It's at least 10 years that as a National Copernicus User Forum, we are working on an improvement of the use of Earth observation for the operational services in all the sector in Italy, both public institution, but also on the market. Just to set the context, we have structured a primary law where you have what we call a mirror of the administration, but also of the governance at European level, equal to the national level. There is a space committee in the Prime Minister cabinet, and the space committee is using the National User Forum for the Earth observation operational services. We have almost copied the European law where we have a Copernicus committee and a Copernicus User Forum. The National Copernicus User Forum is important to give you some hint, is the fact that it's discussing both the development of the upstream part, but also, and is based mainly on the development of the downstream part. That is one of the driver also of the development of the upstream part. Based on the work that the user forum is doing, we have highlighted a long roadmap that I will describe briefly. We are using this roadmap that we have set up in almost 10 years to use the next generation EU investment that is around 4.5 billion between 2022 and 2026. Italy right now is investing in Earth observation infrastructure, both upstream and downstream, around 4.5 billion of investment. In this investment, we all know, and after me, there will be some presentation in this direction. We all know that we are developing also new constellation, that is the Iridio one. I'm always underlying that this is only one of the part of this giant investment. It's a big investment, is around 1 billion euro. You can understand that the biggest investment in Italy is on the downstream part more than the upstream. Of course, they are correlated, but what Italy has really worked within the coordination of the National User Forum is the real development of what we call the marketplace, of like developing infrastructure for services. Firstly, tasks to the institutional operation, but not only so. These services will have to go also on the market. The Italian strategies, it's really to bring and to accelerate the market uptake process. This is done by expanding the user buyer base. What we are trying to do is the fact that most of the time, both at European level, I'm always underlying also the user forum at, in Brussels, that Copernicus and the Earth Observation is a very successful program, but the real end user is not yet reached. So what we are doing in Italy is trying to extend the user, end user domain, in order to have people and areas that are not even knowing that Earth Observation can bring a lot of data, but also information to their business. So in this way, we have set up a methodology in order to link really the scientific and technological innovation to what are the European Framework Directive obligation and the implementation of the European Framework Directive at national level. So in order to have a way much more higher adoption of non-technical and local regional governmental authorities in order to improve the number. In this scheme, we have used the National Copernicus User Forum, that is, as I was saying, a forum where delegates and representatives of the national institution are sitting, but then we have created consultation board, national boards, and then we are using a lot of European Copernicus network that are the Copernicus Academy, the Copernicus Relay, and also the Copernicus FPCAP network of member states to bring the discussion of needs and gap filling. And you see that we have set up consultation board related to defense, but also to infrastructure and transports, Ministry of Cultural Heritage, Environmental Protection, and so on. So this is a structured forum that brings more than 900 participants in the discussion. So we have set up what we have call a permanent national working group to coordinate Earth observation-based activities. This is really important, and we have used also funding from the FPCAP scheme to create this roadmap. So the user consultation, it's really the base to have information needs and translate that to technical requirements. And this is done using user requirement collection, user requirements analysis and clusterization, and products analysis, and what is the gap that has to be filled, both with Earth observation, new satellite mission, but also with new type of services. And this has led to the first plan for the development of Earth observation capabilities in all the three sectors, upstream, midstream, and downstream. The work was done from all the participant to the user forum. So we have an individuation of 8 thematic services that will start from what is already available from Copernicus, so what are already the data, the information that is already delivered from the European level, and which are the national services that will be built based on Copernicus plus the gap filled by the national investment, like the Next Generation, but also an investment from the National Space Agency and other investment that we will see. So we have 8 services, and I'm always underlying that these 8 services are not delivered by a single investment. So it will be not only IRIDE, that will be the another investment for the Next Generation EU from Environmental Monitoring Services and so on, but is the use of all these investments to bring to the full operation of these 8 services. Another thing that is the national coordination scheme is the fact that these are not only new services. A lot of these services are already up and running, let's say, in the national civil protection, in the national environmental monitoring system, and so on. So these services will be integrated. And the scheme is bringing also the private industry to contribute to these operational services. So also to open the public institutional operational services to the real market that are using the Earth observation. Going fast, Giovanni. So the Italian strategies is aiming at constructing a transaction friendly digital market where anchor customer will be the base of the investment, but then the industry has to bring their own investment and their own development. So most of the time, the operational public services do not care about how many satellites are going to be used and delivered for their services. They want the information. So in this scheme, it's really making a sort of like marketplace initiative where industry and providers are making and matching what is already available and what can they solve in terms of gap fill of the user requirements. So in this scheme is to trigger and match new demand and the offer and build what we call the win-win situation. So based on that, and this was one of the questions that Giovanni was asking me, all the investment, so the 4.5 billion, are going to cover not only the upstream, that is, you know, the most known, the yearly investment, is really filling way much more on the downstream sector, the infrastructure of the midstream and downstream, but also the investment of producing new PhD position and also infrastructure for HPC calculation and so on. So it's not only about satellite, but it's really how to use all this data information to produce new information that is of use of the operational services. So you will have, and I will leave the presentation, the full amount, and all these investments are, you know, have the same schedule. So you have the Earth observation of the IRIDES that is, you know, led by the Prime Minister office. Then you have the Ministry of Industrial and Sustainable Development, but you have also an advanced and integrated monitoring and forecasting system from the Ministry of Environment. And of course, all the investment of the Ministry of University Research. So you have some detail about what is the Mirror Copernicus that is really based on the fact that there's a huge investment on the industry, but what is really important, the industry has to work closely on the already operational services that are already running into the public institutions, so the National Civil Protection, but also the Ministry of Cultural Heritage. So the Mirror Copernicus program, the creation of a national research center in HPC, big data and quantum computing. This is another 320 million of investment based on Next Generation EU, based on Ministry of University Research. The same apply with the IRIDE system, where they match these requirements, bringing some gap filling in all the three sectors. In the upstream part with the new constellation, I think there will be an intervention in that, the downstream part, but also the services. So which are the gap filled that this investment can bring? Then we have also an investment of 80 million that is Cyber Italy, so the digital twin of Italy. And also in this case, we are trying to figure it out how much of this digital twin production can be customized and bring to the attention of the European Union. We all know that also Destination Earth is going in that direction. And last but not least, we are investing with the National Monitoring and Forecasting and Tracking System from the Ministry of Environment that is funding all the in-situ network, all the thing that is really needed to bring into coherence with the Earth observation. The last few slides is the fact that what Italy and the coordination of the Copernicus User Forum is trying is making the players can arrange in a multiple way. So it's not like the the usual scheme of a contract services, but with a co-funding of the enterprise and the industry. So the idea is focused as it is. So you have a phase of customized services to paying not for the infrastructure, but paying for the services. And this is an evolution that also at European level, it's clear that has to be, looked at. If we look to IRIS², but also to the new Copernicus, or whatever we want to call it, Earth observation resilient services that the European Commission is setting up, they are really pushing for a public-private partnership in that direction. The last two slides is the fact that, as I was saying, there's a huge investment with around like 2,000 PhD position each year for the next 4 years for PhD related to Earth observation, climate services, and space science technologies. So what we are trying to bring is not only investment in infrastructure and services, but also really making a new generation of people that can then operate, because the sustainability of the services is also based on the people that are really available at national level to operate the services. Thanks.
Andrea, thank you very much. I think you were also within the time, so maybe if If someone wants to ask for one or two questions, that's the right time to do it. No, I don't see any, also because I have the light just in face on me, but that's another story. No, okay, so Andrea, thank you. Please stay here for the final discussion. So now I would like to call the second speaker. We have a slight variation for the program. In the ED, the presentation will be given by Dr. Antonio Ciccolella, that I would like to invite here, which is the system manager of the IRID system. So, Antonio, the floor is yours. Then we will continue to describing other elements of this big picture that Andrea made for us.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for inviting ISA to give this presentation. My name is Antonio Ciccolella. I am an ISA engineer, currently a system requirement manager of IRIDE. I am rather involved in the infrastructure development of IRIDE. I will give you an overview of the IRIDE development with particular regard on the infrastructure, and in continuity with the presentation that Professor Taramelli has just made. So IRIDE is the Italian PNRR Earth Observation Project, and covers the realization of a system composed by upstream, downstream, and service element that is devoted to the development of a geospatial-based service market at national and European level, and primarily to serve the public administration. The services are focused on the needs expressed by the Italian authorities, as mentioned before by Andrea, with the aim of a progressive involvement of local administration and the private customer, fostered by the creation of a marketplace and the development of startup and small medium enterprises over the national territory. The role of this nascent industry is also to have the specific task of educating and training the local administration in the use of geospatial information, as well as in the use of development of services and in the customization of existing services. And this is expected to constitute a stimulus to the space economy in Italy. So the ignition of the space economy could start from here. The IRIDE project involves the development of a flexible, native, service-oriented constellation of small satellites, or better, a constellation of constellation. And this project will develop an Italian national system under the control of designed Italian authorities. And such development will be based on an open architecture in order to allow the system to become part of a larger virtual constellation to contribute to the elements that are developed in other contexts, such as Copernicus and the Italian national programs. The build-up of the system will be achieved in step of progressive completeness, but also allowing the evolution of performance of the various elements at a later stage. Private co-funding will be encouraged later on, with the sustainability and the durability of the system being the major target of such large public investment. This is a concrete way to accelerate the results of past investment, notably from ASI, and also to introduce a new industrial methodology a new paradigm that today is also followed at European level by Spain and Portugal and by Poland. So in these slides, you see the very short development times that have been imposed by the PNRR. And this has not allowed to take into consideration, at least for the upstream and the downstream, new technological solution that would require long studies and risk levels that are not compatible with the required schedule. Namely, we start from the beginning of 2022, just setting up the team and having the document of the National User Forum at our disposal. And we start some architecture definition studies giving to the stakeholder of IRIDE, so small, medium enterprises through their association, to large system integrator and through the users, the possibility to express their opinion on the way they saw this architecture. Then, in parallel, we had a throughout investigation of the resources of the country, the industrial resources, to see what was available or what was ready to be available and credibly within the terms that are the boundary of the PNRR. In particular, we have to deliver the ready operational ready system in July of 2026. And we had to place all the contracts before the 31st of March of this year. And this has been a huge burden of work that still is present. By the way, we have achieved at least the milestone of the first milestone, placing 30 procurement actions with industry. So you can see here the amount of you can see here the budget that is involved. It is 800 million from the European Union, and 300 million from the National Complementary Fund, which altogether made about 1.1 billion euro. And all this to develop the upstream, downstream services and the services. As I mentioned before, the milestone has been achieved, the first one, to assign all the contract within by the 31st of March 2023. And now we are progressing towards the second and most fundamental milestone, that is to deliver the system in July. In June 2026. This is not an ELISA program, it's an Italian program, and also methodologically is not an ELISA program. In reality, in ELISA we have the specification that come from the scientific community usually. And then from this, we write the mission requirement document, and then the system requirement document, and then we go to an invitation to tender, that and then the development follows. Here, this is not possible because the PNRR imposes, as you can see from the previous slide, a very stringent schedule to achieve that can be done, so 2.5 years, usually a space program takes 5 years. So what we could do is to explore the status of readiness of European industry on one side, and on the other side, report with frequent meetings to the user forum, which are led by Professor Caramelli, And we have been working in strict contact together with ASI and other stakeholders in this recursive, I would say, process that has brought to a definition of the system and of the constellation. So the user needs are taken certainly in consideration, but also mitigated by the capability and what credibly industry can provide. For this reason, our contracts, our procurement actions are divided in two parts. So it is industry that in this time proposes, commits to performances of spacecraft. Of course, these are endorsed by the user forum, and they decide a first batch of satellite that they can provide. And if the timing, the way this progress is good, then they can also have a second batch of satellites to manufacture. This is the only way that we have to guarantee that a sufficient number of satellites and a consistent constellation is in place, and at the same time also to create an industrial engagement, because they know, industry knows, that the realization of the system is in their hands. And there is no way to go back, because time is of essence. We need to deliver the 30 June of 2026, and who is in is in, and who is out is out. So what are our implementation driver are inclusive. We are finalizing the definition of the architecture and the technological solution together with the user forum, industry, academia, and the research center. This is distributed. We do not rely on single company in order to avoid a single point failure, but we are oriented toward the modular scalable architecture that is the only way to enable the system to be expanded at a later stage. We do not rely on single solution or a single supplier. The development are staggered. And we have also strict development checkpoints. We have already started to do that. And in December, there will be the bulk of these checkpoints that we have to manage to organize. So IRIDE is also a multiplier of past investment, as I mentioned before, of ASI, of Ministry of Defense, of commercial companies, of self-funded initiatives. And our objective is also to enhance existing system capability to become part of a virtual system of system, including present and future space infrastructure that will be developed by Italian Space Agency, and of course Copernicus, from which a lot of data and information are taken. So this is the picture, and the constituents on the upstream, we have four categories of spacecraft. One is a microwave radar in X band. Then we have hyperspectral, with the invisible and near infrared, so we go up to 2400 nanometer. Maybe later on I will provide you with some more detailed data. We have a multispectral satellite. This is a constellation of small satellite with 3-5 meter resolution in the RGB range plus other frequencies. And then we have an optical very high resolution that is slightly submetric. We have also stipulated some initial contract with launch services, with Vega C in particular. And then we are developing in parallel the downstream, the FOSS, the PDGS, and the central mission control and planning, together with Marketplace and Cyber Italy, as mentioned before by Andrea. And then the services that are both the IRID service and also some initiative oriented to the local public administration uptake, which is at regional level, just to be clear. So this is the architecture of IRIDE as we have conceived it. The integrated upstream, downstream, and service element, and its harmonization, the harmonization with Copernicus and with the national missions, and also we have not to forget the in situ assets that provide a lot of information for Earth observation, constitute the system architecture of IRIDE, and this is a fundamental factor for implementing an operational system. I can provide, you know, just for a short description, you have the constellation on the top, that is the upstream element. Then each constellation has its own flight operation segment. Sometimes it's provided by the manufacturer of the spacecraft himself. Sometimes is provided by IRIDE for larger spacecraft. And then we have a payload data ground segment that utilizes auxiliary data, for example, for calibration, in particular from Copernicus, that is the worldwide reference for this kind of activities, for calibration in particular. Then we have connection with external entities, and then we have the connection with the users through the marketplace. So this is a zoom on what Andrea has shown before, and this is the marketplace as we imagine, and this is an open and scalable digital platform that is organized around categories of thematic services. And in line, of course, with the needs of institutional users, the platform aims at offering the use of data, information, resources, and tools for processing, joint processing, for providing user with the direct access also to the services via this microservices element that you see in green on your left. The marketplace, therefore, is an essential part of the downstream element, and it is expected to support industry, especially small-medium enterprise, to develop a market addressing the institutional operational needs around the thematic of interest. I don't go further in detail on this, but it is worth mentioning that the marketplace contains also element for security and for eventually shutter control. And now we go to show you the spacecraft, the constellation. This Earth observation constellation will provide mostly systematic services with the possibility also of accepting requests on demand, and will be mainly focused on observation over the Italian territory. What you we see here is the Sun Nimbus constellation. In our procurement action, we foresee to have six Nimbus at the first stage, plus additional four at the later stage. So 10 SAR Nimbus altogether. It is a mixed band SAR with a operational bandwidth that is very high. We are talking of 1 GHz. And this enables also very high resolution. As a peak power of almost 4 kW, a single polarization, The antenna is 3.6 meters long, and the performance range between 15 and 50 degrees. So this element per se could enable you to calculate the GSD and other elements, so the resolution. The SWOT is it works in three modes of operation: Scansar, strip map, we have a SWOT that is closer to 30 kilometer. Initially was greater than 23 kilometer, and what is more important is the orbit, because all SAR go in a SSO orbit down dusk, about 6 o'clock p.m. or a.m., second if it is descending or ascending. This spacecraft has the flexibility to perform also in other local time ascending nodes, but especially in an inclined orbit of from 44 degrees onwards. In our formulation of the constellation, we are considering to have 6 satellites in a configuration with an inclination of 49 degrees at an altitude of 525 kilometers. And in this case, we increment the passage on Italy, and we can use also the residual part of the orbit for taking spotlight pictures in parts that are of interest of the Italian users. And this is a big innovation. In Europe, there is nothing like this. And this is a real added value that we are bringing to the European context in this field. We have also another SAR developed by the Orbit and a company called MetaSensing. This SAR reuses a platform that was initially developed for other scopes. So it was a transfer vehicle for placing in orbit a small satellite, but has not the flexibility that I have shown you before. And this is essentially in a down dusk, 6 o'clock plus minus 1 hour. And has a resolution of 2.7, 2.8 meter, and a download capacity of 3.3 megabit per second, so while the previous one has a capability of 1 gigabit per second. And this will be used to complement the orbit that of Nimbus in SSO orbit. We foresee to have one satellite for the first batch plus another one for next batch. This is the Nimbus platform, but adapted for very high resolution one. We have optical band that is RGB plus a vernier channel with a good signal to noise ratio and a decent MTF, modulation transfer function. The ground sampling distance is below 1 meter. We are talking about 0.9 meter at the orbit. This is foreseen, that is 460 kilometer. And it has the capability of taking a strip of 10.5 kilometer wide for 1200 kilometers. So it can have a continuous acquisition of 200 seconds. And The reference orbit is like all optical system around between 10:30 and 14:30. Of course, not noon to avoid sun glint and taking into account the solar zenith angle. For all the system, the lifetime is foreseen to be 2.5 years or at least 5 years. Then we have here a hyperspectral constellation. It is a spacecraft that has been built by CITEL, and Leonardo will provide the payload capitalizing on the experience of PRISMA. So the spectral range is between 400 nanometer and 2.5 nanometer, like PRISMA. And the signal-to-noise ratio is very good. We expect to have a 5 meter resolution in panchromatic and 21 meter in spotlight and 31st in strip map. That will be the mode that will be more used. The SWOT is about 21 kilometer, and it can have a continuous acquisition after until 142 seconds, which if you multiply for 6.5, you see that has almost 1,000 kilometer in strip map. Then we have a small spacecraft, one built by Argotech, and the payload is built by Officina Stellari. It's a small spacecraft with 60 kilo mass, with a resolution of 2.66 meter or 7. Almost 8 meter for multispectral. Has a SWOT of 10, almost 11 kilometer, and can take images continually until 560 kilometer, which corresponds to the saturation of the mass memory on board. The signal-to-noise ratio is good. We use for many application. We use a time domain integration of 4. And so 4 pixel will be used to generate a single strip. And it can work with a maximum of nadir angle 13.4 and as a payload memory storage of 240 gigabit. And finally, there is to go back, we plan in our procurement, we have 10 spacecraft like this for the first batch and 15 for the second batch. Finally, we go to OHB Italy and Optech. OHB Italy takes care of the platform and Optech is the manufacturer of the payload. We are talking of a very light spacecraft, 25 kilos, but with the RGB, a higher resolution because it is the aperture of the spacecraft is used. So one of the faces of the spacecraft is almost all aperture. Has a very good signal-to-noise ratio and can take images of 16.3 kilometer wide for 350 or 400 kilometer. What is important in this payload is also the presence of AIS, Automatic Identification System, that could cover regions in the Mediterranean that are not covered by ground elements. So I hope to have given to you a complete overview within the limit of the time allocated to this presentation. So, as I said before, we had 30 individual procurement actions. We have 34 satellites in the baseline plus 35 that are on the batch 2 that will be ordered depending on the progress. We have described the downstream, the services. I think that's the presentation of Andrea, and the one that will follow will be concentrated on this and launch services. What are we doing now? We are finalizing all the mission aspects for each constellation to close the loop with user needs and identify the constellation flexibility to move forward the proposed mission ranges. So in orbit, we are going to freeze all these elements. And meanwhile, we are monitoring the evolution of the contracts and supporting the developing of the assets that I would say today they are, some are in at the beginning of phase C and others are in advanced stage of phase C. I think I have finished my presentation. Thank you very much. And if you have any question, I am here. Thank you.
Okay. Yes, thanks very much, Guido. And this question, I don't know if it maybe is for Guido or still back to Andrea, but I mean, obviously, this is a very substantial investment, but as far as I understand, it's a one-off investment. But at the same time, we're talking of kind of building fairly dedicated and targeted services at institutional level with the private sector and things like this. So in talking about the kind of the longer term view and vision for this, what are you saying about continuity of these investments into the future? So that's one thing. And then a second smaller question, I'm not sure either from Andrea or from Guido, I heard anything said on the data policy. I wondered if you could say anything about the data policy. Thanks.
Thank you, Mark, for your question. I think that those questions should not be addressed to ESA, but this is in the hand of the Italian government and the decision that the Italian government will take for the authority that will be in charge of the infrastructure after the 30th of June of 2026. We are not in the position to offer you an answer. We can speculate, but the real answer is in the end of the Italian government. And perhaps Andrea wants to complement with this, but one thing is for sure, that you don't invest 1 billion and 70 million of euro to let this reality to, you know, to drop this as soon as the constellation finish their lifetime. I believe that this cries out for an investment even later and for an organization that can involve also commercial entities, perhaps, and depends very much on the governments to come.
Okay, I can complement a bit. I think that also Giovanni will have an hint on the sustainability of this investment. Of course, the idea was like to use the next generation in EU to have a bootstrap in that sense. And that's why we are discussing with the actual government how to pose a sustainability up to 9 years in the next national MFF. In order to have, as I was saying from the beginning, a 50%, let's say, paid by operation by national institution, and then the rest of the 50% has to come from the market and from also the space industry that are building this this upstream part. Of course, another issues, also Copernicus at European level is evolving, as I was saying, if we see the IRIS² issues, but also, you know, Copernicus has not enough money for a sustainability also from, you know, Copernicus as it is right now. So, or we change in a sort of like, you know, public-private partnership in this direction, otherwise also Copernicus, if I just count the next generation, the expansion mission and so on, so now we have with the UK agreement, you know, that they will be covered. But if we look, Mark, to what is Copernicus in the next MFF, there is no money. You know, all the money that will cover Copernicus, it will be just for the operation of the upstream part. So where are the services? So I think Italy and Europe, in a way, have to face reality. There's a change of paradigm. That is what they call the new space. That is not just, you know, contract with the, you know, private company. It's something that has really to change, because the sustainability, both at European level and a national level, cannot be, you know, just on the public institution shoulder. So as far as I know, I don't go in details, is the fact that some of the, you know, space company or, you know, in the industry that are, you know, building this satellite, they also, let's say, offer, you know, a sort of like a new scheme that if we build that, then if we can, let's say, use and manage the ground segment and so on, so we can go in the market direction, then we can invest in that direction. So it's the discussion that at European level and national level. And then I add something that, you know, like Italy, we are really pushing, and the answer from all the interested entities of Copernicus is positive. We want to, let's say, build all this investment using the boundary condition that all the interested entities at European level, which are the development that all the interested entities are doing, so that the national investment will be, you know, in line on what is the evolution at European level, both of the upstream part and, you know, the downstream part. I was discussing this during lunch with another, you know, delegate. I don't make the name, but the point is the fact that there's a change of paradigm also at European level. Do we have the money at European level to sustain Copernicus as it is? No. That's the reality. There's no money, especially with the expansion mission and with the next generation. So what we are going to do, so, and this goes to the second question you made, like what is the data policy? Also in this way, I do think that Italy, but also European, you know, Union has to change from data policy to service policy. It makes a clear difference if we discuss the service policy, so the not data, the information availability. And that's, you know, I was fast in the last two slides, but this is the question. It's not only data policy, how, you know, who is going to use the data? Also because we have a European framework directive that is saying that national investment or like public investment has to give for free this data. That's a European framework directive.
I have seen that you have established specific services, but I do not see anything related to biodiversity monitoring. And within GEO, a lot of work has been done in different projects. So there are some downstream services that could be very useful in this framework.
It's not in details, but it's inside the land monitoring services. All the biodiversity is there, and also in another services. We didn't go through details, but
we will go in detail in the next presentation.
In the next presentation, but it is covered.
Okay. Well.
Thank you. So I think we will have time to hopefully to discuss also at the end. So now we go to the next presentation. Also here there is a variation. My colleague Francesco was not able to come, so I will present the ASEAN activities. So if may I have the slides. Okay, so this is the presentation. Of course, the ASI institutional role comes, I would say, well before of this specific action that we are trying to describe. And as it was mentioned, is as I would say a double aspect. On one side is the basis for what Antonio said, okay, what is available today and what can be reasonably available by mid-2026. On the other side, this is my personal view, I see the ASI program, that is a continuous program, as probably the research, development and demonstration part of what could be the continuation of the IRIDE constellation, continuation of the current national missions that are operational, and that probably the ASI program will find its natural development into this infrastructure and also at service level, this may be the same. So this is a view in which we can already say that at least one element, research, development, demonstration, may be already there to ensure the continuity and sustainability and improvement of what we are developing with the PNRR. The next, please. Okay, so this slide is quite crowded, but it's trying to put together the objective of the Italian Space Agency in the Earth observation domains and the mission that are operational, the red ones, the ones that are approved, that are under development, that are blue, and the green one that are still at the stage of initial definition and possibly for a consolidation in the near future. So you see that, of course, the bulk of the national mission operational is Cosmos KMed, as you may know, so in orbit since 2007, the first one was launched. Then we also have PRISMA, that is the precursor hyperspectral. And we also put at the bottom in the frame of the SIASG agreement with the Argentinian, we have access and priority over Europe of the L-band SAR data coming from the SAOCOM satellite Argentina. Then you see a number of follow-on missions. So one line of development is the Platino, that is this multi-purpose platform that ASI is developing. And then we have many missions in cooperation with the United States, mainly with JPL. We will talk all of them later. So, okay, this picture is almost the same as the first one. Here we try to connect each mission with the wavelength of the instrument on board. And we also try to put in the same slide what we are doing at the national level and what are the major contribution of our industry for the ESA program. So the objective here to try to show a kind of continuity in the priorities and in the activities at overall level. So national program plus ESA program. Okay, going to go a little bit inside each type of mission that we mentioned. So we start from the microwave. So here you see what I can say Cosmos, KMed and beyond. So we have we have a first generation Cosmos KMed still in orbit. At least three of them are still working. So we have also the second generation, of which two of them are in orbit with, as you can see, some improved performances from different point of view, the resolution, the SWOTs, the type multiple polarization. And then we are already thinking to the future, and we are thinking at the multi-band system especially, but also on bistatic application. So bistatic means that one satellite send the signal and another satellite, a different satellite, receive it. so that present some benefits for the type of products that can be obtained. And well, so you show the three axes of development, improvement, ensuring continuity over time. So then Salcom, as I mentioned, so from the agreement with the CONAI, the Argentina Space Agency, Italy has the exclusivity of data over Europe and on the Mediterranean, let's say, and all over Europe. And so we are, we will see at the end another slide, we are constructing a data archive for Salcom with priority over Italy and also for Europe that could be made available for further application. And in this case, could be a good precursor for one of the next Copernicus missions, the Rosel. Cosmos Chimera is just to put in the same slide the plans, so you see the four satellites of the first generation, the two of the second generation that are already in orbit, and the other two that they will be launched in a couple of years. Okay, other missions, the one related to Platinum. So the Platinum one, unfortunately, I must say that the accident of Vega C is delaying all our plans. So all the Platinum launches were planned with Vega. And so this is the Platinum one that is a SAR mission with mainly bistatic application. So as I said, the bistatic is a technique that on one side for the interferometric application increases the baseline between the two satellites and so increasing the accuracy. And on the other side, the specific mission has some application related to, let me say, listen to the noise coming from Earth in order to improve and identify this noise in the actual products that will be produced. So launch today, I may say probably end of 2024. So it was planned earlier, but okay, we are waiting the new launch manifest from Vega. Sorry, that was okay. So going to the electro-optic things. So we have Prisma that is, of course, in orbit, is operational. Here we have in this diagram a comparison between the Prisma performances and the CHIME requirements for the signal to noise ratio. Of course, as you know, the Prisma data are accessible. We have to consider that Prisma is not an operational satellite, especially for its operational arrangements. The products are, as we are told from the scientists we are using them, are very, very good quality. But of course, the possibility to obtain data, sequence of data, is limited by the operational capabilities. Then we have phase B, the Prisma second generation, that of course we have redirected after the in conjunction with the four hyperspectra that were presented by Antonio, part of the IRIDE. So now Prisma second generation is working on improving the ground resolution of the hyperspectral products. We are aiming at 5 meters, and probably this will be supporting the IRIDE, but also the CHIME, the upcoming CHIME Sentinel. Platinum 2. It's Maya, it's a multi-angle imager for aerosol. This is a cooperation between NASA and ASI. For NASA, the JPL is the actor. So my objective is to link exposure to different type, to different concentration and type of PM and ELT. The products we expect will have 1 kilometer of ground sampling, and we will have concentration of PM10, concentration of PM2.5, and also speciation, sulfate, nitrate, organic carbon, elementary carbon, and dust. So, and you see in the picture, these are the area in Europe that will be subject to Maya observations. So on this, as Nicola was mentioning in the overall presentation, we have activated a pilot project with CNR, an agreement ASI-CNR, to really try to downscale this process, these products at urban scale. I would say so the objective is 500 meter, and hopefully better, we will see, in order to really go to exposure risk and exposure indicators, also supporting some SDG indicators. Okay, this is a picture that on the left you see the instrument that has the capability, gimbal capability on track and cross track, and on the right you see the observation scheme. So it's the same scene will be seen during the same pass from 5 angles, and so this will provide better accuracy in determining the depth of the optical depth of the aerosol, and then all the consequent modelization to go to the concentration of the PM. Oh, this just to remember to myself that I'm a space agency, that we need also other data to have final products. So here you see the key components of the Maya, so the instrument, you have the surface monitors, you have the models, and you have your epidemiological data. For this thing, the data policy is quite clear, is open and free. So the Maya products will be made available freely over, at least for Europe, over the areas that I was mentioning. Of course, there are other areas in the world that I didn't picture here. For this, for example, from what you will hear later for the IRID services, if succeeding in this kind of experimentation, this could bring quite good improvements, even if I think of to Copernicus services on air quality. So now the grid, if I'm not wrong, is 10 kilometers. So this could become quite a grid improvement. Of course, at demonstration level now, but then this could be a further developments in operational missions, both national or European level, if so needed. Another joint mission we have with NASA JPL is the Surface Biology and Geology Mission, the SBG. So in this, for you know that the mission is made of 2 satellites, one of, with the hyperspectral payload, another one with the thermal infrared payload, plus a veneer payload. So ASI here is providing the spacecraft for this thermal infrared spacecraft and the veneer instrument. Here you have the characteristics of the two payloads, the TIR, the TIR and the veneer, and also just picturing the area of the application for the TIR. Of course, the mission, the SBG mission, is considering the joint use of the two satellites to achieve the scientific goals. Okay, so up to now, these are all approved missions. So they are in development. Delays can happen as usual in the space program. Here we have a couple of other missions for which we are in discussion with JPL and with NASA. So the first one is OSIO-NEXT, so the next generation of the orbiting carbon observatory. Of course, we expect that this mission will provide a key contribution and is complementing somehow the CO2M Copernicus, because we'll add probably to what CO2M is expected to measure the sources, we'll add a mapping and the overall behavior of the carbon cycle in a hotter environment and with increasing number of extreme events. So on the right side, you see the instrument complement. So you have the instrument for the CO2, CH4, and then the fluorescence. So ASI will do the plans are that ASI will develop the fluorescence instrument, building on the FLEX heritage, the Earth Explorer mission FLEX. So this at this point, this mission is under evaluation by NASA. If selected, ASI has already the go ahead to start the definition of the mission from what our contribution is concerned. Okay, this is probably is in the wrong place, but you will. So these are the payloads that we are developing. Of course, some of them, in particular the hyperspectral one, is the one that will be on board the IRIDE that was presented. So we have also a thermal infrared payload for small satellite that most probably will go in the Platinum 4 mission. So we are still understanding what how to do. In fact, it was on the Platinum 2, but then the agreement with NASA, we made a switch to embark the Maya payload. And then you have the very high resolution payload that is not the one that was presented by Antonio, is another one with hopefully with better performances developed by Leonardo, and probably will go on the Platinum 3 mission. The time frame for launch of these elements is something we don't know yet exactly, but is something between 26 and 28. We are almost at the end. Here there is also Caligula, is the LIDAR mission that is still a very early stage. We are just running a phase 8 contract for the definition of the instrument. ASI, in principle, will provide the LIDAR transmitter, and also this one will be in cooperation with NASA that is supposed to provide the receiver. Finally, it's nothing to do with the space mission, just a couple of words of Map Italy. So since 2010, Cosmos CAMED is regularly mapping in strip map mode the Italian territory with a pace of about an interferometric couple every 16 days. And so we have this huge archive that now we are really trying to put at the disposition of our institutional user, adding also the SAOCOM that I mentioned before, and adding also the Sentinel-1. So to have just in one place all the SAR data that are today available in X, Cosmos SkyMed, C-band Sentinel, and L-band SAOCOM. For SAOCOM, as I said, we are also collecting data over Europe but of course also SAOCOM has some operational limitation, but we will try to do our best to construct this archive that we think will be very useful in the future, but also for the development of the IRIDE services that you will hear in a few time from now. Okay, I think I'm finished, and thank you very much for the attention. Okay. Okay, if there are questions, couple of questions, so I... Okay, so quite exhaustive and clear, no? Okay. Okay, well, so we may go to the next speaker, that is Laura Candela from Italia Space Agency, that will give us an overview of the, on one side, of the approach from the Italia Space Agency for the promotion of the downstream and services development, and also a quick overview of the what we call service value chains that are developed within the IRIDE as of today. Laura, thank you.
Thank you, Giovanni. And I have to introduce and briefly describe what is the approach that in Italy we are following to develop the service, to prepare the services. So we have two different domains that we are using to develop services. The first one is the ASI domain, and in this framework we have a number of different initiatives, different programs that we use to promote the service development. And the IRIDE service domain, already introduced by Antonio and Andrea before, in particular, in the ASI domain, we have a number of programs that involve deeply the user in the loop of development through partnership, through the use as starting point for the service development of the needs that the user have. So, in particular, about our strategy in for national downstream development as ASI. In the recent decade, Italy has invested a significant effort in developing both space technologies, as Giovanni before said, and in developing a set of services, promoting data exploitation, promoting the service user-guided service development. So we have promoted the development of value-added application and services based on EO data. Not only the EO data that are acquired by satellite, developed by ASI or managed by ASI, but in general, promoting the use of a multi-mission, multi-sensor upstream segment. Our aim is to accelerate the scientific and technological development of services and to obtain the implementation of demonstrator pilot project used by final user to test the capacity and the possibility offered by the satellite tool. So we have encouraged the use of data we have encouraged the development of service at territorial level. Also, we have encouraged the development of new technologies, taking into account the different sensors that we have developed and managed in this year, starting from the Cosmos SkyMed of first and second generation, considering Prisma, the L-band, SAOCOM data, and so on. And all this data we have promoted the use together with the Copernicus Sentinel-1. So, in this framework, in the ASI strategy in developing downstream, have two lines. The first one is the so-called data exploitation programs, where the sensor, the mission, is the driver of the development. We have Prisma Scienza, SAR multi-frequency, and open call based on Cosmos SkyMed data. Together, here you can see as an example the some term that the SAR multi-frequency program helped to develop: agriculture, urban area, sea and coast, natural risk. In all these cases, the data exploitation has been focused on the joint and harmonized use of SAR data coming from L, C, and X-band sensors. So, about the new program of ASI, the so-called Innovation for Downstream Preparation. This program, born at the end of 21, is now the main program of ASI for the development of the downstream segment. And it brings together the experience of the coming from the previous initiative and with the idea to support public and private stakeholders to develop new innovative services. The main focus is to stimulate the downstream sector innovation and growth. So this is a pre-operational program, in generally speaking, because our idea is to start from an effective user need and to prepare a new downstream, a new service chain. We have articulated this initiative in three lines of intervention, and we issue periodically call, where thematic call, and in this. This initiative, the theme, the content of the service is not defined by ASI, but is defined by the public administration, by the market operator, by the scientific entities that respond to our call. We have a number of eligibility criteria, and we select between the proposal the proposal that are more linked to interest of ASI, linked to the an effective user need, and with an effective innovation potential. We don't pay two times the same activity in any case. The first call has already the first result. For the public administration, we have we are establishing some partnership with Autorità di Bacino del Po, Toscania Region, the ARPA of Lazio Region, and with CNR / ISPRA, the last one project. Corro, okay. The market, this is a picture of the first result of the first call. The same for the science, and where in this case the theme is the sustainable cities. Next call, we have a new theme selected for market and science. All the call are already published, and we are assigning the contract. Public administration, we published the new call in few weeks, I think. Okay. IRIDE in parallel. Andrea and Antonio have already introduced the initiative. Also in this case, the users is in the loop, both because the user need are on the basis of the service of the user requirement that are driving the service development, but we have regular checkpoint with the user during the program evolution. In the service development, we have two phases mainly. The first one, the actual, is the so-called precursor. In the precursor phase, we are putting in the place the status of the art, the actual capacity to operate the services. In the second phase, we will introduce progressively the IRIDE data, adapting the elements, conveniently the elements of the service value chain. Very fast picture related to all the service value chain. The first one, coastal and marine monitoring, that is articulated in three service value chain or more service value chain of the second level. Coastal monitoring and forecast wide area, coastal monitoring and forecast specific area, coastal area mapping and monitoring. Second one, air quality. Also in this case, air quality monitoring and forecast, monitoring and assessment of pollutant emission, reanalysis, air quality at national scale. Ground motion is a articulated portfolio based on the interferometric capabilities of a number of different SAR mission. The first line is devoted to map the ground motion at national coverage. And following, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different service value chain with a thematic scope related to map, ground motion for landslide, cultural heritage, critical infrastructure, volcanic area. The last one is different for the operational characteristic of the service value chain, because this service value chain will operate on demand. Land use, and here we have the habitat mapping, urban head island monitoring, green urban area characterization, and coming back, land cover, land use mapping and monitoring, land consumption, soil ceiling monitoring, land consumption, soil ceiling mapping. Land use, so on, we continue about, we have 17 different service value chain. This is land use land cover, forest, hydrometeorological climate. In this case, we observe, we develop hydrometeorological mapping and monitoring atmospheric structure, monitoring of greenhouse gas and other SCV, classification of herbaceous agricultural crop, lightning monitoring, water management, focused on the hydrological and hydraulic modeling, river hydromorphological mapping and dynamics, integrated water resource management. The last two services are quite different because are typically on-demand services. The first one dedicated to emergency response related to rapid mapping and detailed damage mapping in relation with a number of different emergency that typically are problems in Italy. And the last one is a line of services related to security at maritime level and land level. So just a snapshot about the implementation. All the services are grouped in four lots. And here you can see the industrial team that is working to develop all the service value chain and the pilot users, the users that has been involved in the teams, in the project teams, to support the implementation, to guide the implementation of all the lines of services. This is the second, the third, and then the fourth lot. An example that I go. So to close, okay, the Italian Space Agency through I4DP program has put in place a tool that constantly provide help for the development of services and application useful for the management of multiple strategic sector for the country, encouraging interaction with and between the community of commercial, institutional, and scientific users to prepare the future operational downstream. IRIDE, in parallel, is developing an operational framework for the institutional services, starting from the status of the art, and then in phase two, introducing the IRIDE data. The IRIDE precursor phase is also built on previous downstream services and data exploitation program. Some of them was founded by IASI in the past year. And we think that the national future ecosystem post 2026 of downstream institutional services will be based on the contribution both of IRIDE and ASI investment. In any case, users are and will be deeply involved in both process of services development. IRIDE and I4DP are intrinsically user-driven. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. So I cannot allow any question. I would like to call Giovanni Siro Stabini, that is the CEO of Planetair, but also the Vice President of EARSC, to to give, okay, the, let me say, the commercial perspective to all these developments. Giovanni, I'm sorry, but you have
5 minutes.
Yes, let's say 5 minutes.
Yes, I understand I'm between you and the social dinner, so I try to be fast. My presentation is on. So I have 2 minutes.
Still 4 points.
Well, while the presentation go on, one of the questions at the beginning of this session was about sustainability of IRIDE. I believe that, as correctly said by Andrea Tanarelli, we have an overall problem of sustainability of air observation in Europe. These are the data of the last industry survey of ERSC, and the revenue of the earth observation upstream market in Europe is about 1.8 billion euro, and these are made by a very fragmented industry. We must keep this in time in order if we want to plan for sustainability of this industry in the future. So more or less the market opportunities for small satellite constellation, if we look at the largest part of IRIDE constellation, is in 2026. Obviously, industry concern, but I believe also government concern, is about the long-term sustainability of this. Thanks with the support of ISA, the our national organization of industry, IPAS, made a study and tried to understand what are the total addressable market for this kind of constellation. I cannot go in details, but I believe you can have a look about the presentation. You will see that the largest part of the overall 20 billion on the next 10 years will be in the downstream. So it's really impressive how few resources are invested in developing downstream service normally. The addressable market for IRIDE in the next period after the closing of the development phase will be about 5 billion, and so about 26% of the market. In our study, we understand that this market cannot be reasonably completely sustainable with commercial, with the government demand. And it's also true that typically commercial demand and earth observation downstream service in its vast majority is from government. If you look at the typical small sat constellation of the competitors, this case is Planet, you can see that the largest part of demand is made by government demand, and typically by US government demand. And considering that we are in competition, when I say we, I don't say Italy, I say Europe, perfectly, we have to look at the opportunity to build really some true market around earth observation. This is a famous slide from Mariana Mazzucato that show how much of government there is within an iPhone. Just to say that the story of not government support US industry is an old story. A lack of capability in Europe to open new market and an orientation to make market fixing. So we have the crisis of iron problem like this, but we are difficult in building a market. So few suggestions, I cannot go in detail, I understand. introduce mission-oriented innovation and use Earth observation for this. This means, for example, have a more commercially oriented Copernicus program, because if we say that we want to have together to government support also commercial sale outside Europe, and this is true as well for Italian IRIDE constellation, develop an anchor demand. And this is an egg and chicken problem sometimes, but if you don't have the anchor demand established, it's very difficult to attract private investment. And this is normally what happen outside Europe. There is a growing interest of private equity and venture capital, but a lot must be done on the road of demand establishment. Then also on our side as industry, the downstream industry must embrace really in developing a system and service what's happening from the digital transformation. There is a long story in this, but consider how much many customers we can have if we can move our service from human user to machine-to-machine service. So, in the end, we believe that if we can push Europe and, in our case, Italy in this three direction, we can have the opportunity to establish a sustainable Earth observation, but also to drive the market at global level, because we have one of the best industry, a lot of the best research, as you will see in a few seconds, and this can assure us the lead. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the very intense presentation in very few minutes. Thank you so much. So, just to give the floor to our last speaker that is being confined in really in a corner. So Nicola Pirrone, just to give some consideration from the
their point. I will not use my PowerPoint, but I think many I am impressed, honestly speaking. I'm impressed from all past presentation what is the reality in Italy and the huge investment, and I think there is a lot many opportunities for GEO to really enrich the data value chain. We have been talking many times in different meetings in the context of GEO about how to link investment and with the data and users, and how to fit in all the policy makers' needs and keeping in mind stakeholders' needs and requirement. So I think during the next 2 days, and also during dinner tonight, we can have opportunity to build several consideration on how to make GEO and specifically EuroGEO more attractive. There is a lot, you know, we have Italy is an example, but I'm sure that also in other leading countries like Germany and France and Greece and other European countries, we have similar situations. So really, Earth observation market, it's the future, and also a big opportunity for scientists. So it's time now to act, and to perhaps the post-25 strategy that will be approved in Cape Town in a month or so, is the start of a new decade. And I'm sure that also during the several sessions tomorrow, but more importantly on Wednesday morning, we will discuss the overall approach of EuroGEO and how to link, you know, how to make profitable the data space, data technology. And I strongly believe that involving the private sector is a must in this challenge, because research will work on the cross-cutting edge issues, but private sector can really make this commercially available, all the outcome, all the progress that we will make also in science will be will have an impact on social and to increase equity. This is a key word in the post-25 strategy. So I will stop here, and I encourage everyone to be in touch with the speakers that have been providing a lot of information about the Italian case. But so thank you so much for your patience, and I look forward to a rich discussion during the next 2 days. Thank you.
Well, I think that this may end the session. My